brainwashed in the cycle to spin. We write our own stories like America again.
You know, one way of solving a lot of problems that we've got is letting a person feel that they're important. And a man can't get himself together until he knows who he is and be proud of what and who he is and wait and where he come from and where he come from.
Hot damn, Black America again. Think of Santa Bland as I'm staring in the wind. The color of my skin, they comparing it to sin. The darker it gets, the less fairer it has been. The hate made, I inherit it from them. But I ain't gonna point the finger. We got anointed singers like Nina, Marvin, Billy, Stevie. Need to hear them songs. Sometimes to believe me, who freed me? Licking a Cadillac, drinking a battle rap. So is it God's speed that we travel at? Endangered in our own habitat. Them guns and dope, man, y'all can have it back. As a matter of fact, we them lab rats. You built the project for, now you want your hood back. I guess if you could rap, you would express it too. That PTSD, we need professionals. You know we're pressing, dude. It make the pipes bust from schools to prison, y'all. They trying to pipe us to your political parties. Invite us instead of making voting laws to spite us. You know we from a family of fights us. Fought in your wars and our wars. You put a brother in Star Wars. Maybe you need two. And then maybe then we'll believe you. See black people in the future. We wasn't shipped here to rob and shoot ya. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Our men and women are created equal, including black Americans.
You know, one way of solving a lot of problems that we've got is letting a person feel that there's somebody. And a man can't get himself together until he know who he is and be proud of what and who he is. And where he come from? And where he come from?
We are rewriting the Black American story. 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 Black American story. We are rewriting the 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 Black American story.
This world is one great battlefield with forces all arrayed. If in my heart I do not yield, I'll overcome someday. Someday.
Like the Civil War itself, slavery didn't end with one decisive act. After the Battle of Antietam in September 1862, President Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation in January 1863. It declared all persons held as slaves within the rebellious states to be free. Northern abolitionists welcomed the proclamation as a first step, while Southern slave owners ignored it. Ending slavery would take a constitutional amendment passed in January 1865, Robert E. Lee's surrender at Appomattox in April 1865, the heroism of many enslaved families, and the Union Army itself to personally deliver the news to the most remote corners of the conquered Confederacy.
The proclamation that Lincoln signed didn't find its way into Texas, which is where my father's family is from, and the Rambo family, until mid-June of 1865.
On June 19th, Union General Gordon Granger arrived in Galveston and personally delivered the news.
The people of Texas are informed that, in accordance with a proclamation from the Executive of the United States, all slaves are free. This involves an absolute equality of personal rights and rights of property between former masters and slaves, and the connection heretofore existing between them becomes that between employer and hired labor.
There was a lot of celebration, but there was also a lot of sadness, a lot of concern, a lot of fear. Both enslaved Africans and those who held slaves didn't know what really to do now. As freed Americans, where were we to go?
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Beyond the Gatekeepers. I am Reverend Dr. Vanessa M. Brown. I'm your host for this evening. And tonight we will be talking about Juneteenth. How did you feel when you come out of the wilderness? Do you know that you are free? I'm so excited about our guests, the panelists we have. We're going to ask them to turn their cameras on and their mics. And we're going to introduce them individually and allow each one of them to tell us a little bit about themselves as we go along. Our first person tonight is Bishop William Barber II. He is a bishop in the College of Bishops for the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries, TFAM. He is the senior pastor of Greenleaf Christian Church in Goldsboro, North Carolina. And he is also the president of Repairers of the Breach. Welcome, Bishop Barber. Can you tell us something else about yourself?
First of all, I'm so honored to be here with all the other guests and so humbled that you would ask. You know, I'm a son of born in Indiana. I was born on August 30th, 1963, 2 days after the March on Washington. And the story is told that I waited a couple of days to see what was going to happen. But I was born right in the movie. My earliest memory is my mother and father screaming. And for years, I did not know what it was. It was when Dr. King was shot, and I was almost 5 years old. That's all I remember from those early years. I remember them screaming at that white TV with the rabbit ears. Currently, I'm with the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, and right now in the middle of this massive Poor People's Assembly moral march on Washington that will take place on this Saturday, 10 o'clock, www.june2020.org, and that's about all I can think about right now in this moment. But I'm just so humbled to be here and to be a part of this conversation.
Thank you so much, Bishop Barber. Our next guest is Dr. Valerie Bridgman. She is the Dean and Vice President of Academic Affairs and Associate Professor of Homiletics and Hebrew Bible at Methodist Theological School of Ohio. Welcome, Dr. Bridgman.
Hi, I would add that I'm also the president and CEO of Woman Preach Incorporated.
Excellent.
And my shiro, has long been Harriet Tubman, and one of her quotes, "Guide me, I would be free or die. If I can't have one, I have the other." And so right now, what is fueling me is thinking about how to make education revolutionary more so than it already is in my mind as a womanist scholar and a womanist preacher. That's the work that's fueling me, that and praying for my children and their children, that they would be safe in this moment, in this pandemic, and every way that we can say pandemic. I think we're on the precipice of freedom. I don't know what that means, but I hope I'm right about that.
Thank you, Dr. Bridgman. I also would like to say that Dr. Bridgman is also a part of our College of Affirming Bishops for the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries. And so we thank you. Our next person is not a visitor. Amen. She helps me to co-host this show on a weekly basis, and I'm grateful for her. She is Bishop Yvette Adrian Funder, our presiding prelate of the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries. She is also the senior pastor of City of Refuge United Church of Christ. Bishop, will you have a few words?
Good evening, everyone. I greet you from our motorhome tonight. Our motorhome is named Aunt Prim. That's what's on the license plate. It's named after my grandmother's oldest daughter, my Aunt Primrose Martin, who has passed away. And she's the one that introduced me to motorhomes and fishing and going out and being in the elements. She was a huge, huge asset to my having that opportunity as a city girl. So I lift her up tonight. I'm also very grateful to be in the company of these warriors. Each one of them in different ways are justice warriors, everyone that you will meet tonight. But I want to lift up in particular Dr. Forrest Harris, who's going to have an opportunity to introduce himself. In the not too recent past, I was invited to the American Baptist College to preach and to teach, both as a theologian and as a preacher. I was invited. And there was a hue and cry about that reality from some kindred that were a part of the Southern Baptist Conference, and they had a bit of a fit. And I want to say about Dr. Harris, the way in which he not only stood his ground, I was not the only one threatened, but he was threatened, and his job and job security and his role at the school. But we went right on and did it. And we had a glorious and wonderful time. And I'll just say this, Bishop-elect Brown, Reverend Dr. Brown, there was one sister that I recall that met us in the lobby when we were there. She walked up to me and she said to me, "I'm from Mississippi." She said, and I was giving God one more chance to give me some hope.
Yes, she did.
Before I took my life. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
She had made an appointment to kill herself the next day. And she took the chance to come to American Baptist College to see if she could hear a word of hope. And she told us in the lobby that she had decided to live. I want you to know, Dr. Harris, that she still lives.
Yes.
And that moment that we had when we prayed for her, she found strength and she went on to be a voice for liberation in her own state. Mm-hmm. Thank you all for all being here. I have stories like that about Bishop Barber, about Reverend Dr. Valerie, about Pastor Darrell Goodwin and all of the things that he has done, and certainly Bishop Pearson and our work together. But I am so, so pleased to be in the company of these justice warriors tonight. God bless you. And thank you for giving me a chance to share tonight, Bishop-elect.
Amen. Amen. Our next guest is Reverend Darrell Goodwin. He's the associate conference minister in the Iowa, Nebraska, South Dakota conferences of the United Church of Christ. Welcome, Reverend Darrell Goodwin.
Good evening, everybody. Similar to Bishop Barber and others who have spoken, I am humbled to be amongst this great cloud of witnesses and justice warriors, people who are not only using their mouths to talk, but they use their lives in this walk towards justice. The only thing I would offer tonight as an introduction is one of my favorite scriptures. It's Revelation, the 12th chapter and the 11th verse. And I like this particular translation of it. They triumphed over. And that can be racism, that could be homophobia, a lot of the things we're holding right now. They triumphed over by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. And I think this is a season for us to not request justice. It isn't this season for us to demand justice, but it is the season for us to command it, because we've now earned through our life and our legacy the authority to command it. And I believe it's going to be so.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Amen. Dr. Forrest E. Harris, Sr., President of American Baptist College. Welcome, Dr. Forrest E. Harris.
Thank you so much, Vanessa. My heart is kind of pulsating right now at not only the opportunity to be with you all and to share in this space. It's pulsating because there's so much hope in these kinds of moments to encourage us and to give us some sense that the future that we all believe in as it relates to God's justice is possible, simply because we have the courage and the tenacity to move into these kinds of spaces and speak truth. Thank you so much for inviting me. And the story that Bishop Flonda tells is so akin to the kind of spirit that she has herself, as she shared in that moment with us at American Baptist College. And it made such a profound difference in the way that the students and the school itself began to understand its real mission of training social justice leaders. It was a fight, of course, and we finally got it to a space wherein decisions were made on behalf of the college through the courts that we had every right to be a school of higher education without the authority and the consensuship of a group or denomination determining who our trustees are going to be. So that has been a critical point in my own professional life. I'm also a professor of Black Church Studies at Vanderbilt Divinity School, been doing that for now 32 years, and 20th year of being president of American Baptist College. But I think this is a critical, critical moment. And I think you're right, Darrell, it's a moment to command justice. It's also a moment for us to understand that the Black church cannot remain as it has been if it's going to be a commander of justice. And the most recent decision of the Supreme Court, landmark decision as it relates to the LGBTQ plus community, is a part of what we must discuss in terms of the justice that we must command. And I'm so glad to be a part of this discussion tonight. And thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Harris. Last, but certainly not least, is Bishop Carlton Pearson. He's an author, progressive spiritual teacher, and thought leader. We're so very, very happy to have Bishop Carlton Pearson with us this evening. Bishop, will you say a few words?
Thank you, Bishop-elect. It's always an honor. This is my fifth time. I get to meet and hear from some of the most commanding voices and minds. When I think of the opening of the slaves, those beautiful, sad but beautiful pictures, and then I'm talking to some of the brightest minds, freest people on the planet. Even though Juneteenth took place, was announced in 1965, there's still regions of our country that have not fully experienced the true emancipation. They've heard the proclamation, but they haven't experienced the true emancipation. And I'm in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where the worst race massacre in American history occurred. And there's a lot of tension in our city, as you may all know tonight, because as Spike Lee calls him, Agent Orange is coming to town this week. He would have been here Friday night, and
right,
we shoot him away, but he's coming, and they're packing out the largest building in our city, which seats 20,000. They're lined up right now, camping out. This is Wednesday. He doesn't come till Saturday. And they say there's 1 million people. This is a huge slap in our face.
Yes.
Huge insult to the dignity of the African-American community in Tulsa. And the president probably will make no reference to the massacre, though he's asked to be for a tour. There's just so many, my emotions are so mixed, and I don't ever remember feeling more emotion and devotion to my emotions, which is leading to a little bit of commotion, just over this whole energy that this man has unleashed into this country. But the good part is he has been a big coming out party for all the haters on the down low who have hidden that hatred in their Bibles, in their buckles, in their churches. And these are white evangelicals mostly who were active 100 years ago in the massacre. And I'm feeling a huge sense of not victim consciousness, but I'm insulted and feel assaulted. But the good part is we're not in trouble. We're in transition. This is an unveiling. The universe is clearing, cleansing and correcting itself, purging, purifying and perfecting itself. And it's taking the exposure of the rot that is in the core of this country, that it might ultimately be expelled. And we are really on the front line. And most of you have been there longer than me, as far as actively engaging in justice issues. Thanks to Bishop Flunder and now Bishop Barber, I'm more involved, more engaged. We Pentecostals weren't that engaged. Bishop Yvette is one of the first to actually get out there. So I'm growing, I'm learning, I'm expanding, and I'm excited. And I'm eager to hear what you all have to say. God bless you all. It's an honor.
God bless you. Thank you all so very, very much. It'll bring me right to one of the questions I want to ask, but I also want us to mark the fact that today is the fifth anniversary of the massacre of those people in Charleston, South Carolina, while they were sitting in Bible study, having church, and a young white boy came in and shot everybody that was there. And so I want to mark today by saying that is I don't believe it's a coincidence that we're even having this conversation on today. But Bishop Pearson was talking about something that's actually one of the questions, so I'm just going to go right to it. I want to say that in 1921, it's a neighborhood that was in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in Greenwood, was one of the wealthiest Black communities in America. It was destroyed in a race massacre, as Bishop Pearson has already said, burned to ashes. And the dead were marked into unmarked graves. First time in American history, bombs were used on American soil to destroy American people. Black hospitals burned. White hospitals refused to take the sick in. Over 150 to 300 people were counted amongst the dead. And no insurance company would honor any insurance policy on buildings, on houses, on any kind of property, and on any lives. And so I think my question to you all today is, because we have experienced all of this over 100 years ago, it seems like some of this stuff is still real and visceral in the lives of so many people. We can never get this community back. What can we do? What are our recourses at this point so that Greenwood never happens again? I'm going to ask Bishop Barber to weigh in first.
Well, I want to add a few pieces to that what you just did in that description. Now, we say 1921, right?
Yes, sir.
If my mind's memory serves me correct, that is right during the time of the presidency of an open white supremacist named Woodrow Wilson, who was different than Trump because he was very educated. He's the president of Princeton, former governor of New Jersey. He is the president, he was the president that played Birth of a Nation in the Oval Office.
Yes.
And told his staff that this is the history that was needed. If I'm not mistaken, that Twin Tulsa it reflects a series of riots.
Yeah.
Can't forget Wilmington in 1898, 2 years after Plessy versus Ferguson, and the other riots. So this was a series, and at the same time, Black men were being hung on an average of one per day.
Yes.
1920, a white legislator from Ferguson presents an anti-lynching bill and he gets kicked out of the legislature. Mm-hmm. We're also talking about there was a pandemic.
Yes.
The president lied about the pandemic. Mm-hmm. He said it wasn't real. And it cost 650,000 lives. Mm-hmm. This was also the year after Red Summer, mm-hmm. when Black people were run out of places all over the country, mm-hmm. during that time. And we were coming out of war. So one of the things that we have, you're exactly right, is that if, you know, we know it biblically, what that scripture that says, if you don't deal with the demon right, it comes back seven times.
Stronger.
And so America is dealing with this demon of racism, right? But I love something that Bishop Pearson said, and I know he knows what he said, but what he is that there is a necessity of pulling off the covers and exposing it if you're gonna deal with it. And I think mm-hmm. part of our role right now is to go on and pull it all the way off.
Yeah.
See, yeah. don't just make it about police violence. Racism has always been about death. Death mm-hmm. to protect it, death because of it. Death is the DM. Death, racism has always been on the DM. There's always been a death measurement. Everything racism touches, when you connect it to classism, kills. So part of our role right now, we make a mistake if we define this moment just by police violence and one person, as gruesome as it is.
Sure.
We need to, part of, if we don't want to deal, we have to help let's pull the covers off, let's pull it all the way off. Let the rot be seen, because it's only in the seeing that's gonna move some people. Just like Emmett Till's grotesque yeah. body, the only yes. thing that moves some people, mm-hmm. you know, so pulling it all the way off. And I think that's part of what we have to do in this moment. In order to deal with, the last thing I would say is that America right now is being offered, is asking a question. And the question we're being asked in the midst of all of this is, can America even be?
Mm-hmm.
Can she even be who she has written that she says she is? This is really what's before us. It's so much bigger than politics. It really is about, can we be? Because in a few years, we're going to be the only country in the Western Hemisphere, maybe in the other ones too, where the former slaves and the people who are brown and black have the majority mm-hmm. of a country with the level of economic power and military power that this country has.
Powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And
that, my friend, is scaring some folk.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? So I'm actually thinking, what part of what we do, if we don't want it to happen again, we got to help pull the covers. I mean, it's, you know, just pull them all the way off so yeah. that we can help folks see how yeah. racism is targeted at Black folk and brown folk and First Nation folk, but racism ultimately is targeted at humanity.
Yes.
It is a killer. And if you stay with it, it's going to kill you.
Murderous.
America yeah. see that.
I agree.
I mean, I think Bishop Barber, you point on, spot on. We know the culture of slavery did not end in 1865. The neo-slavery system of Jim Crow continued in manifestations, and it mutated in various forms and continued to seek to co-opt Black humanity, brown humanity into a system that continuously killed, maimed, created poverty, created the violence. And yet, as you just pointed out, in this present moment, the police culture is a part of the system
mm-hmm.
and systems that continue to impact the flourishing of Black and brown people. And if we can now, in this moment, pull the covers back. I said earlier today in a conversation with one of my good friends, Phyllis Hildreth, is that we need to do a complete inventory and let that inventory begin to speak to America about how racism kills, and connect the intersectional character of racism to education, mm-hmm. to jobs, to economies, to families, to communities in a way that this moment can, if it's going to be a turning point rather than a tipping point, push us toward transforming the system of what we've suffered for so long. All of us got some stories that relate to how racism kills. Got some cousin, some relative incarcerated, someone who died for poor healthcare, someone who has been limited in their opportunities simply because of these systems. So I am very much in tune with what you just said in terms of pulling the cover way off.
So the question around, you know, we can't get Tulsa back, you know, Black Wall Street, it was called.
Yes.
Or any number of the Black cities that were thriving before white vigilantes and terrorists went in and killed people and destroyed homes and businesses. It's true, we can't get those back. But it's also true that most people don't know those histories, mm-hmm. Black, white, or otherwise. And so part of the work is to, one, remind Black people that we have in our bones and in our DNA the ability to thrive and to build societies of thriving, of churches and businesses and communities where we really can build those. We have it in our DNA. We've done it before. We can do it again. That's that part. The other part is the history. Call a thing a thing. Those weren't race riots. Mm-hmm. Black people were not rioting. They were defending themselves against violence, against terrorists. And so calling a thing a thing, naming it rightly, will help us go forward, right? Mm-hmm. So that's that. And then the last thing I want to say about that part is, you know, one of my favorite quotes from Malcolm X is, if you're not willing to die for it, don't call it freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think we're at a point where I speak for myself. I'm at a point where I didn't have very much backup in me anyway. And I sure don't have any backup in me right now. I just think I'm not interested in appeasing white people's guilt or appeasing their need to feel comfortable, which, and you know, I say to my students all the time, comfort is not a spiritual gift. You got to give that up as a proposition. And, and white people needing to feel comfortable for the sake of our freedom is just not in it's not in the equation for me. And so I'm committed to people's discomfort and so that we can get over this disease.
Yes.
Beautiful.
May I add something?
Yes, ma'am.
I think a lot about and reflect a lot about the story of Exodus. And the reason that I think about it is because in order for the Exodus story, if we move away from the nationalities of the people and just lift the story for a minute, there was an oppressor that was using the skills and ability of an oppressed people and holding them in slavery. And then there were a group of people that experienced an emancipation. And on the other side of that emancipation, something incredible happened. They, after a month and a half, by the telling of the story, they begin to lust again for Egypt.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because God was giving them food for the lean time, manna, it was called. And the word manna, by definition, and Dr. Bridgman can help me, it means, what is this?
Yes.
And I think a lot of folks are caught in what is this? What is this? Essentially, they begin to lust for the flesh pots, the stew pots of Egypt, even though they were in slavery, as versus the lean moving through with manna. And I'm saying that because, and this is a difficult thing for me to say, but I'm saying it because I think that a lot of my people have been compromised by having a small seat at the table. Mm-hmm. And they've been, there's another word for it that I will not use on this gathering, but it's called house something. And I'm gonna leave that other part up for your imagination, okay? And I've seen them on television. I've seen them. I've heard a lot of things that they've said. And the people that feel like that they prosper, well, mm-hmm. prospered more in Egypt than they can in the wilderness. And my point is that if we are really going to see change, we have to be ready to travel lean, which means we have to divest ourselves from the places where we are compromised and where we are compromising our people. Now that's going to be complicated because there's a price attached to that. A real price. I need to let that sit in the air for a minute. A real tangible price. But in this particular time, I don't think you get the both and. I think you have to choose the either or. And that has to happen for us as people of African descent and people who have been affected historically. So how much are we in it? When we really take a look at the price of what freedom really will be, what reparations we need to demand, and how long we're going to have to fight. How long have these children been in the street? They've been in the street a long time, but I don't think being in the street is over. There's some more things that have to be done. And there's some things that some of us, and I say this and I'm done because this is dangerous what I'm about to say. But some of us are going to need to divest ourselves from some of the relationships that we have, that we are connected to because we are doing it for peace sake, because we are the token at a table.
It's when you say what price freedom, because that's what I heard, what price freedom is. How you? I feel like I can say this because I've done it. How willing are you to? What are you willing to lose? And how willing are you to walk away from? Some people and some things, for the sake of not just your freedom but your people's freedoms. And you know, I get a paycheck. I get a government check. But I also know the freedom of being willing to walk away. Like I have had to say I ain't gonna die here.
Well, Dr. Brown, one of the things that I think in this moment, we got to have some real cross theology. What I mean by that is, you know, everybody wants the resurrection and whatnot, but cross theology or mourning theology. I'm one that I actually don't think we need to stop mourning anytime soon. I think that this nation needs to hurt. And I don't even want a quick bill. Now, that may sound crazy, but see, a quick bill that they're trying to pass now is to put it all back in the box. And you know, just do something, put it back in the box. And I watched the day when Republicans were all saying how bad and grotesque and ugly that was that happened to George Floyd, because they want to isolate it to a spectacle. They want to isolate it to one person. And they want to, but they don't want a full pulling off of the covers. They don't want us to really start talking about how racism is deadly, connected to classism, and how it's killing and has killed and continues to kill so much. So we need this season. Blessed are they that mourn. We need this season. Rachel hollering out in Rhema and refusing to be comforted. It's dangerous in this moment to give comfort to people. Let me finish this one point. There's a danger in this moment of too quick. And I want to read this piece that came right after the slave bill, and when they decided they could chase us and go get us, and Dred Scott decision. And this is what Frederick Douglass said. He said, "The people who are doing this are monstrous in their attempts. And it looks like it's overwhelming." He said, but that's one point of view. Now, here's what Frederick said 2 months after that decision. He said, "In another point of view, we abolitionists and colored people should meet this gruesome, ugly decision, unlooked for and monstrous as it appears, in a cheerful spirit, because this very attempt to blot out forever the hopes of an enslaved people may be one necessary link in the chain of events preparatory to the downfall and complete overthrow of the whole slave system." So what happens is
there is a certain death that has to kill racism.
Yes.
There's a certain coming to terms with it. That's why we, as again I said, we can't participate in limiting the conversation of racism to just police violence.
Right.
Right.
We gotta help pull that thing all the way up. And there are folk that wanna limit it there and stop it there and cover it back up, cover it back up. If we cover it back up, it's gonna get stronger again.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah. One of the things that I think
the heart of my statement is that the greatest fear that the Pharaoh types have is that they are going to have to make their own bricks.
Mm. Right. That bricks with no straw.
With no straw. There will not be a community of people that will be diminished in order for another group of people to feel hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And once that reality really sets in, that's when you get the Franklin Graham responses.
Right.
That's when the people just go ape crazy and start blaming it on God and religious freedom and all that. But the great fear is that they are going to have to make their own bricks, and they will not be made wonderful at our expense. But we will have to pour our resources and our strength and our skills into our own communities.
Yes.
And that is huge for us. That is huge for us.
Part of it, though, Bishop, as you were saying, that the struggle I have is the other tension here is part of the Egyptian narrative was if you can get people to forget that they are the children of God and that they are enslaved, then you've capitalized on something. I think inherent in your question, Bishop-elect, is Black Wall Street was. I actually think that's part of the falsity of the narrative. There is a version of Black excellence that attempted and was destroyed, but Black excellence has continued. And I think when we remember our name, when we remember the power that is inherent in who we are, we remember that that particular Black Wall Street birthed other Black Wall Streets all over this country and this nation. Yes. When we talk about who owns web services and entrepreneurial spirits and everything that's there, it is yet again present and alive and well. I think when we rehearse the narrative of who we really are, that's what, quote, the oppressor doesn't want you to remember. They want you to remember you had it and it was taken. Now what? We want you to know that these are the downfalls of your culture. And now what? But we have to reclaim that. One of my favorite stories is about my great-great-grandmother, who right after slavery became a midwife and walked through all of the back roads of Mississippi to deliver Black babies all over the place. That story is important for me today because I know that I can be my great-great-grandmother as a midwife today. That story didn't end because she passed away. It was something my family passed on to me, and therefore I have to embody that spirit, even going through the back roads if I have to, and the front roads, and therefore claim that my people made the roads, so it's ours. You know, I think that is the encouragement and the empowerment. We rewrite the narrative, reclaim the narrative, and tell the truth. And it exposes the falsity that I think we're trying to be imprisoned by.
This is good.
Can I say?
Yes,
I think what you say, Bishop-elect Darrell, is something actually that Bishop Barber has said, which is, well, I'm putting these two together, that Black joy and Black brilliance and Black excellence can exist in the midst of Black lament. And
indeed.
I think the challenge is that people think we have to do one or the other.
Right.
And in fact, we're doing them. It reminds me of the story of when the temple was rebuilt, that the sound of lament and the sound of joy went up at the same time and you couldn't distinguish between the two. We're capable of dancing and lamenting at the same time.
Yes.
Of producing while we are also crying. I mean, we're pushing at the same time that we are lamenting. I mean,
the mourning I'm talking about, though, is the Howard Thurman kind of mourning, where you mourn deeply because you mourn, you're blessed because you mourn at a level that forces you to fight for change. Mm-hmm. And what I'm saying is America must be broken. And right there, listen, there are only four ways that history shifts according to some people. War, environmental destruction, economic downturn, and mass mobilizations that come out of people feeling like they're being killed and wounded. And all four of them are happening right now.
Yes.
And so in this moment, America wants to put up, but the mourning in the street is the hope, because it says folk haven't given up yet on their possibility or the possibility of this nation. The worst thing we could have is people see all this stuff and not care. Part of what I'm trying to articulate, probably not doing a good job at it, is that until America is really broken, and one of the things I'm finding as we go in the hills of Kentucky and places, is not white folks' guilt, but we're starting to help white folks understand racism killing you.
Right.
It's killing. It ain't about you feeling guilty. Do you want to live? Do you want to live in these hills? Because you need to understand that the same people that use race to get elected, when they get elected, they pass bills that keep the insurance from you, and you have black lung disease and can't breathe.
Right.
And there's something about when folk get that. So right now, before we got to George Floyd, we're in this midst of this mourning, 100-some thousand people dying, and then we find out 69% didn't have to die. Now that happened on top of 700 people dying a day from poverty. Because the reality is 61% of black folk are poor and low wealth because of the greed. 61%. So when that question about that you ask about Tulsa is part of it, what we have to do in this moment to rebuild. I think we're in a third reconstruction moment.
There
are forces that don't want to see it happen.
Right.
And there are forces that know, but the question is, do we know it? Because I've watched Brother Forrest, I've been watching these debates, mm-hmm. and even some of our black legislators, God love them, I help them all, but their demands aren't matching the moment.
Right. Demands aren't matching the moment.
They're asking for too little.
Yeah.
We need a reset.
Not a repent.
That's right.
Reset. That's right.
Jubilee. Stop everything.
Everything.
Right.
And reset.
Yes. You know, heard David Chappelle. He was the prophet the other night. I don't know if y'all seen that piece.
Oh, it was beautiful.
David Chappelle said, let me tell you something. All this in the street is we sick of all of it.
Right.
The worst thing we could do in this moment is interpret what we're seeing in the street, these young folk, these black folk, these white folk, these gay folk, these trans folk, as it just being about one thing that happened in Minneapolis.
Exactly.
Right.
I can't breathe became shorthand for how a whole lot of folk are feeling. Folk are starting to say, they may not even know they're saying it, but in the spirit, they're saying, wait a minute, the same spirit that would crush that boy's neck is the same spirit that'll make me go back in a meat plant and work with no equipment. The same spirit that would suffocate that man on camera is the same one that would sit up in Congress and have health care, but won't allow other people to have it. It's the same spirit that'll pass three bills in the midst of a pandemic and not deal with health care, not deal with living wages, not deal with rent forgiveness, not deal with moratorium on water, and will give 84% of that money. And if we can mourn just a little bit longer, folk might decide that we all better, that a remnant of us better stay together and challenge this racism and this classism that's hooked together and is killing all of us. Yeah. That's the point I'm trying to articulate.
There's a lot of...
Can I... Go ahead, Brother Pearson.
I didn't mean to interrupt you,
President. Please get in, Bishop.
There's a sense of, among a lot of young African-Americans, never, if I hear the song We Shall Overcome Again, I almost will vomit, because that song has always made me cry. I heard it the first to recall when my grandmother was standing in the kitchen in the 60s, watching black folk at the South, and I was in Southern California, being hosed down in the street. She had her hands holding this woman, wouldn't dare cuss, had her hands on her hips, and a fork from frying chicken in her hand, and she would go, and shake her head. I'd glance back at her, look at the screen, glance back at her, look at the screen. She didn't break it down for me, but I cried. She hid her tears from me, but she cried. I was in Beverly Hills when and Westwood and Bel Air just a couple of weeks ago, and they were having all these riots, demonstrations, mostly peaceful, by mostly white young folk. And I saw some of the black kids, not many, but some of them saying, you know what? Donald Trump lost by 3 million votes. My grandfather, my great grandfather, my great grandmother, my mother, they marched. And we're still dealing with this stuff. I'm gonna go get me a big screen TV, jump in one of those stores. I'm gonna get me a new laptop, give me some shoes, go home and watch the demonstrations on my new television. I ain't marching. Now you talk about the mourning that Bishop Barber referred to. There's an anger and edginess, and there is an exhaustion out there. Right. Along with the mourning, mourning, there has to be an mourning. Mm-hmm. We gotta give them something to look for that is promising and powerful. And I think we're seeing it in the young people. We're dealing with symptoms, the source, and I'm right here in the most religious city in the Mecca of the charismatic Pentecostal world. Oral Roberts was the grandfather. These churches, this is a Trump city, and the racism and the arrogance and the ignorance and this bullying spirit is all over the town. I'm really anxious tonight because of what I'm sensing. And I see it. Last night, we had over 100,000 people listening to us discuss Larry Reed in Atlanta, Rod Parsley, and the comment he made about basically saying, if you don't like this country, leave it. He said, don't hate America. And I said, we don't hate America. We're hurting in America. And you white preachers have got to cry loud and spare not. If you don't, I'm going to cry loud, spare not. Lift up my voice like a trumpet. Tell God's people their transgressions, the house of Jacob.
Come on.
We've let these preachers, and I said, Rod Parsley didn't say one thing, and he's apologized since, but he didn't say one thing about Black Lives Matter. Black tithes matter, they get that. But what about Black Lives? The white evangelical church that really influences the Black church has said nothing except pro-Trump stuff. Now, I think a lot of us is seated in religion. Juneteenth was celebrated in churches by Black people. Church pews, chicken. The church still is the social hub as well as the spiritual station for African Americans. So the church, particularly and the white church, has got to get involved, or we're gonna have to move them out of the way. I think they're a dying entity anyway. But it's, I call it evangelical cults, C-U-L-T. There's a cultism. It's like these people are under a spell. They got King Jesus mixed up with King James, or King James mixed up with King Jesus. King James, 16th century English, said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all the creatures. That's us, Asians, right. Africans, Indians. You know, creatures in their mind is not them. They're white, Anglo, not Catholic, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant. So the racism in the church is a whole base of Southern Baptist church. Right here in Tulsa, we have First Methodist, Boston Avenue Methodist. On the same street, just a few blocks, First Methodist was was pro-abolition. The Boston Avenue, a bigger, more wealthy church, was pro-abolition. And they split. No doctrine, no, or liturgical differences, just race. And now it's the opposite. The Boston Avenue is the more progressive, and First Methodist is more evangelical and conservative. So, we have to speak out to our brothers in that sense and make them rise up, because the other ones, Franklin Graham and all those guys, are shouting out all the support for Trump.
Oh, yeah.
I know Paula White.
And since you made this turn, Bishop Pearson, it brings me to my next question. What is the role of the church? The role of the church and faith-based education institutions with regards to preparing justice leaders and the creation of freedom tools for justice work? What is the role of the church? I'm going to start with Dr. Bridgman, but before I do that, I want to thank our Facebook Live audience for being here with us. We have almost 400 people that are with us on Facebook Live. We ask that you share and like continuously. Somebody needs to hear this conversation. Dr. Bridgman?
So Presbyterian Minister Dabney wrote an apologetics for slavery. And it became the basis on which Southern churches and not just Southern. So I just want to also disabuse us of the myth that the South somehow was more racist than the North.
Right.
it wasn't. I'm a girl of the South. I'm a woman of the South. I grew up in the shadow of Bull Connors, Birmingham. I grew up in 40 miles southeast of Birmingham, and my mother taught us to love freedom, right? So I think the church has the own, and now I work at a United Methodist school. I think the church not only has to own its history of racist theology in encoding racism in its teaching, it has to dismantle it. Right. It has to not just repent for racism, it has to become actively anti-racist.
Yes.
Dismantling the work it has done in its teaching. Our schools have to revisit. We're trying to redo our curriculum. You know how much it takes to decolonize the mind, to dismantle racism in the curriculum, where Black, Brown, other theologians are not the last thing you teach, but the first thing, where you center the Brown Jesus and not the white one, where the work we're doing literally disrupts centuries of work that the church has done in the name of God. Yeah. So, you know, the doctrine of discovery has to be called what it was, demonic and dismantled.
Mm. Yes.
All the way down. It has to be named. I mean, called out, not this kind of fake thing that denominations are doing now and have been doing, where they do a reconciliation gathering with the poor brown people, and they say, can't we all just get along? Can't we just go from here? No, you got to name the BS that you put in the water.
Yeah.
You know, I want to add to what you're saying, Dr. Richmond.
There's poison in the partridge.
Yes.
There's poison in the soup. You got to name that you put it in there, and then you got to make a whole. The other piece, and I'm going to leave this alone, is we got to quit pretending like there's this one small pie that has to be divvied up, and that somehow white people have a table to invite us to. It ain't their table. It ain't their pie.
That's right.
It ain't their soup. You know, literally, the heavens, the earth belongs to God.
Earth is the Lord's fullness thereof.
And everything in it. And until white people who claim to be Christians, and I do mean claim.
Yes, ma'am.
To be Christian, own the fact that they don't own the table and they don't own the earth to share.
That's right.
That's good.
That's it.
As their Black and Brown kin sibling is to keep calling them on that. I'm trying not to cuss Bishop, because you know he's cussing times, and I have a spirit on me, so I'm trying to hold that right now.
I know your language abilities. I know your language abilities.
So I'm trying not to speak in tongues, but what I'm trying to say here is our job is to keep calling that out and not letting them get away with these fake apologies. I don't need another person to call me and say, I'm so sorry that happened. Okay, fix it.
Right. That's
it. Reverend Brown, I've got a thing I've got to run to, because we're planning for June 2020. And I told you I want to say, but I want to add up something onto that. And that is, before James Cone died, I had a deep conversation with him. And I was on sabbatical. And he said one of his great heartbreaks was that what he wrote about Black theology, a lot of time wasn't even preached in the Black church.
Right.
And that we talk about white folk not becoming anti-racist. We got to make sure Black churches are holding on to being anti-racist. And fully engaged, because in some sense, the young folk are more prophetic than the church.
That's exactly right.
I read a book the other day called The Death of the Church. Mm-hmm. It was a church growth book. And it raises the question, is what has to die?
Yep.
Not what do we have to keep adding to bring people in, but what literally has to die.
Good point.
And I think about that text in Matthew, when the Bible says that when Jesus turned over all of that injustice going on in the temple,
the Bible said the young folk got happy. The older folk got mad.
Right.
And when he started healing folk, the young folk got happy. You know, I don't know, maybe they saw that their uncle who had been kept out could now come in or their whatever. But the point is, they celebrated liberation. They didn't, there's nowhere in that text that they had to have a special choir. There's nowhere in that text that said they brought in a special clown and a special dance team. It simply says, when Jesus engaged in liberation and revolutionary acts of liberation, mm-hmm. and said, we're not going to have this in here. This is not going to be a select place, a racist place. It's a house for all people. And I'm turning over all this class and whatever. The young folk got happy. The older folk got mad. One of the things that we got to be careful of in this moment is we can't assume that anti-racism or even anti-poverty is being declared in our churches.
Precisely.
I mean, you know, and I say this real honestly, I had crazy fights with certain denominations with the Poor People's Campaign, even though 61% of our people are poor. Some of them just told me, if you were to say the gay folk not going to be a part of it, we'll come in.
Wow.
In the 20, with 61%. And of course, I used some language that was tongues and sold them something. And I went on and just went on. But my point is, it's not just because you're Black. I mean, even with our legislators, even with people. So I want to slip that point in there. And I think that my professor, Bill Turner, said something years ago. What is the purpose of the church? He wrote an article on Black evangelicalism. And he said, the significant difference in Black evangelicalism and so-called white evangelicalism is that Black evangelicalism knows at its core that if you say baptized, fire baptized, sprinkled, laid on hands, fell in the floor, whatever you describe that experience as, if it doesn't produce a quarrel with the world, it's suspect.
Hey. It's suspect.
It's suspect. Call it what you put a whole lot of titles on it. But if it does not produce a quarrel with the world, if it does not challenge the nations, if it merely is a chaplain to the injustices, if it does not put the potokos, those who've been made poor by exploitations and systems of exploitation, at the center of the good news and liberate them to stand against the systems of injustice, then whatever you call it, it's something. It's a spirit. Mm-hmm. It's something. Yes. But it's suspect when it comes to being genuine, authentic Christianity.
Yeah. Indeed.
And there is a cost.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And the problem is not wanting to pay the cost. Right. You can't be both and in this.
Yes, right.
This now, Bishop Barber, before you leave, because I know you have to go, I do want to ask you a question.
I hate it too. I want to stay right here, but they call
me. I know, but this is a question and it's directed to you. How do we enlist broad and ongoing citizen engagement at every level, but particularly among our youth and young adults? You talk about more, M-O-R-E, mobilizing, organizing, registering, and educating. Tell us what we can do with our youth and our young adults in the midst of this. I think they're already doing it, in my opinion.
Oh, sure, sure.
They're out there on the street, but what else?
Yeah, in many ways they are, and in many ways they are, you know, we're seeing a new world trying to break free and be born, which is why we cannot get in the way of it. Again, when I talk about this morning, I'm talking about the country, not so much Black folk, but I know that America has had to have her heart broken for her to ever change. Mm-hmm. She's got to go through certain things. When America found out how much those signs being up was costing her, that's when they came down. I had a professor of theology and history, named Early Thorpe, wrote a book called Psychoanalysis of History. And he said, Dr. King's genius was, he knew if he could create the tension and put it on TV, the other countries around the world would see it. And then they would say to America, why are you gonna come talk to us about what we're doing? Look at what you're doing.
Exactly.
And created a tension that hurt this country, broke it in a way, and it made them have to shift in some way. So I think I just want to say that when I'm talking about this mourning business, that there's a certain level, it's sad to say, but there's a certain level that this country does not move until you hurt its money.
Yeah.
And hurt its heart. And, right. And right now, both of them are being hurt. It's money and it's heart, because America is seeing, especially white America, is seeing her babies disagreeing with the mamas and daddies.
Right. Yeah.
And your baby turns away from your teaching, that breaks your heart. That's why I'm saying, let the marching go on for a while. Let them babies be out there with the black folk and just let it go, right? Yeah. And then let them expand it. Let them say they're going to deal with all the death. And even though I want to protect from coronavirus and all that, so do some things on viral. But my point is, that's an important reality. Now, how do you do it? I can only tell you what we've done. And I talk like Bishop Flunden does. We have never had to recruit young folk into the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival. When they hear that we are serious about dealing with the five interlocking sins and evils and injustices together, racism, mm-hmm. poverty, ecological devastation, denial of healthcare, the war economy, and this false moral narrative of white evangelicalism and Christian nationalism, they come to us. When they hear that everybody is welcome, and that by religion, we don't mean Christian, we mean some people are religious, some people have moral, their constitutional values from the Constitution, that's their morality. Some people are not even people of faith. You'd be surprised how many people I told Bishop Flunder that guy calls me every week. You know what, Pastor, I'm an atheist. Oh, but that sermon. they come because they see this world like those young folk when they saw Jesus turn over all that stuff. They knew all that oppression was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an ideal deep down in our young folk that's no, it's wrong. I didn't realize it until 2 years ago. And I'll stop here. I came home, 3 years ago. My son was in the School of Math and Science, and it taught me a powerful lesson, Bishop Pierce. I walk in the house, and there was this Asian boy sitting at our table, and a white guy sitting at our table in my house. Now, in my day, you know, you lock your door. Mama would tell you, be careful who your friends are, and so forth and so on. I says, who are you all? They said, oh, we're here working with William. I said, where's William? They said, he's gone, he'll be back in an hour. I said, William be gone back in an hour and you all are in the hospital. And so William came back. So me now, the liberal one, the open one, I pulled him to the side out of caution. I said, son, you can't be leaving these people. You don't know. He said, oh, Dad, that's y'all stuff. He said, we so way past that and we so sick of it. There's a remnant out here.
Yeah.
Sick of it.
Yes, sir.
And Amos 5 will not let me alone when it says in the 10th verse, it talks about evil being epidemic and so forth and so on in the Message Bible. And then it says, even good people are giving up. And then it says, God says, but if I can get a remnant that will go in the street and lament, and will refuse to stop till the lamenting shuts down the factories. That's the Message Bible. Shuts down the streets, shuts down the stores. And then it says, and God says, when I hear that level of long-term lamenting that is really a form of protest, I'll make my visit. And then 4 verses later, it says, let justice roll down. And righteousness like a mighty stream. So I think we have to let young folk know we're serious about a new humanity. And we're serious about challenging these demons together, not one over here, one over there, but all 5 of them, if you will.
Yeah.
And in that, it has a certain magnetism. The young people come, and I'm telling you, we've seen them come and beg. I mean, you don't have to pay me kind of begging, because they're so hungry, some of them, to get over this crap.
Right.
Yes.
Knowing that they're spiritual. And part of what we have to do is be willing to let them in, let them lead, and let them loose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is the new iteration of the church.
Indeed.
It ain't looking exactly right.
Thank you, Bishop.
Yeah, thank you, Bishop.
Please take this so I can get my homework.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Thank you.
Call me, Bishop.
Thank you.
I will.
Okay. In Nashville, 4 or 5 teenagers called a march, and it ended up being about 10,000 people in that march, the most peaceful march that we've had in the country. And as Bishop Barber was talking, I thought about this verse in 2 Kings, I think, said the children have come to the point of birth.
And there was no.
And there's no strength.
To deliver.
But these children are ready to name a new era.
Yeah.
They are ready to name a new humanity.
Yes.
Yeah.
Name an alternative for the future that they want for them to flourish. And they're not resting on the domains of the church and its traditionalism. Right. They're not resting upon the old theology that does no longer have a liberative bend to it or breathe into them new life. They're ready to name a new era. And one of the things that I was going to say in response to the earlier question about what the church can do.
The role of the church, yes.
One is that churches ought to undo, decolonize this theology that has been passed on to the children as they have tried to teach them about salvation. The soteriology that the churches are talking about is the substitutionary atonement theory about how Jesus paid for our sins, rather than how Jesus showed us how to live against the alternatives of God's kingdom, how God brings us into a salvation relationship because we're willing, like Jesus, to deeply center in God's other reality other than the reality of the first of empire.
Right.
That's salvation. And when they talk about baptism back in the first century, John the Baptist and all those who were baptizing, it was a deep political statement. If you were baptized by John the Baptist, you were making a political statement against the status quo.
That's right.
And right now, our salvation, our understanding of the ritual of baptism does not make a political statement. The church has ceased to make a political statement. And that's the reason why Aubrey Hendricks' book is so important, The Politics of Jesus.
Yes. Because
as you rediscover Jesus and all of his teaching, his parables, and all the ways in which he represented that deep understanding and center of God was against the empire. And our churches are not against the empire and the empire's reality. So one of the things I think the church has to do is go back to this theological imagination that our ancestors had, having never gone to seminary, having never gone to a school, but they had this imagination about God that was born out of their experience of suffering.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Out of that suffering, they came to understand about a God who cared about them, who cared about their freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Now we've been co-opted into what Willie Jennings talked about is the imagination of white Christianity.
Yes.
To the point that it has no delivering power for us.
Right.
We're paralyzed
by the here and now, essentially,
yes.
In the here and now, with an eye toward the what is to come. Everything is about getting ready eschatologically to go to another place where the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary shall be at rest. Edward. But it disempowers us to do anything powerful in the here and now, and moves us from the obligation to bring heaven to earth. Thy kingdom come and will be done on earth.
Yes, it is.
On earth.
Yes.
On earth as it is.
Yes. I wanna give Darrell an opportunity to say something, particularly because he is under 40. And so I wanna hear what he is under 40. And I wanna hear what he has to say around the young people engagement. But I also want to hear what he has to say about the role of the church.
Yes.
A couple of thoughts I have. The first one is a couple of weeks ago, I was in downtown Omaha at a protest. And I want to challenge that. I no longer think protest is the appropriate word for what we're experiencing with our young people. I think the appropriate and prophetic word is uprising.
Uprising.
Because when you are finished protesting, like, stop, we don't want this, then you begin to rise up. And when you rise up, you're not requesting anymore. Like I said, you are commanding. And that's what I saw these young people, Black folks and Native Americans and Latino and Asian Pacific Islander. These were the people who were standing, facing the police, facing institution, facing the government. The church folk weren't there.
Nope.
Very clear. The politicians were not there. It was our young people who were commanding that change wouldn't possibly come, but that change would come and will come. I think there has to be this sense of understanding that our young people walk with a prophetic power that is no longer tolerant of appeasement, no longer tolerant of requests, no longer tolerant of someone assuming they have the power and authority to welcome you to the table. Our young people have said, you don't own the table and neither did you make it. So what gives you the authority to say that I can sit here? The scripture that I love that I think we maybe have heard differently because of an eschatological Christianity. And I think we've missed out on this. When the scripture says in the last days, I think what we've failed to add to that is in the last days of empire, God said, I will pour my spirit out upon all flesh, and it will be the young who will do what? They will prophesy. They will dream dreams. They will walk us to where we're supposed to go. This is the end of empire. And I think our young people are looking at us going, didn't you know? Have you not heard? Empire is coming to an end, and it's us. The church, where is the church? Our theology of a justice without Jesus or Jesus without justice is where our young people are saying, I don't understand this. Everything in your quote scripture is about justice. Everything in who this man then which you've talked about is about justice. And so for pastors who are struggling to, how do I preach social justice in my church? Preach Jesus. If they're talking about how exactly do I break down this understanding for my white congregation who may not understand it, then preach Jesus. Because if you really are preaching Jesus, then effectively you are preaching justice. And our young people are asking for that. If they don't hear a revelant and a revelatory word or a rhema word, it is the absence of justice in a real and tangible way in which it makes sense to them. So I think if we look at that, the young people here in Omaha, Nebraska, of all places, to have all of these shades of God's majesty, the mosaic of these young people, who, yes, they did march and they did sing songs, but they commanded for a community that is coming and yet to come. And they were no longer saying that we're comfortable with what has been.
Yeah. Thank you. Dr. Bridgman.
Yeah, I have a, it's not a pushback, it's an add-on. I want to resist the notion that somehow there is some conflict between young people and old people, kind of like the sort of the dialectic therein, because old men are dreaming, old men and women and siblings are dreaming dreams. Young people are seeing visions. We're in the streets together. I mean, I was in Delaware, Ohio, of all places, which is the reddest part of Ohio, if you talk about red and blue states. And I didn't get out of my car, but I drove down to the protest, the uprising. I've been using the word uprising. And watching all these people, some had to be in their 70s, and the four-year-old with the Black Lives Matter shirts on, and they were white. Mm-hmm. And you, I mean, kind of all, and they were, there were Black people out there, but they weren't the majority, not because they're not gonna be the majority in Delaware, Ohio.
Yeah.
It's not. It used to be a sundown town. And on the streets of Delaware, Ohio, I really want you to hear what I'm saying, was this collage of a kaleidoscope of people who were from every age, every ability, probably every denomination. I wasn't out there to talk to them, so I don't know the answer to that. But what I'm trying to get to is the uprising is defying these divisions that we have in our own head, right? I'm a woman of a certain age. I'm not going to march all night long like they were saying in the Ferguson uprising. I'm young, I'm strong, I'm marching all night long. I was like, good for you, and I'm going to pay for the dinner, for the midnight dinner. I'm going to send Cash App, baby. I'm going to give to the bill fund because I don't have the stamina to be out all night long. But this is what John meant when he said, God calls the old because they know the way, the young because they have strength. Well, we may not know the way for our current future, but we know the way God works. And I know when I see God at work. So when people say the church ain't out there, what they mean is a particular kind of representation of the church is not in the street. There are a whole lot of church folk, whole lot of them out in the street. I mean, I'm counseling people every day who say, I want to live my faith. I want to go down to Columbus. Here it's Columbus, Ohio, to the state house. I want to help me with this. We did a one-on-one. I did a feedback with people who, because of their faith, showed up in the street. So when people say the church ain't in the street, they mean a particular performance of the church ain't in the street. But there's a whole lot of folk who love Jesus out in these streets. A whole lot of people who are faithful to their Buddhist tradition. A whole lot of Jewish folk who are faithful to their understanding of Torah and Tikkun Olam, repairing the world. A whole lot of Muslim and Muslim people out here for the sake of their faith who are saying, we got to do better. This country made a claim and we're saying the same thing. I hate to evoke King because I think that's the chief, right? But yeah, the bankruptcy of the country is on display and we're saying no mas. Mm-mm, not doing that no more. Yeah. Yes, we're going to do it as long as it takes. I'm not going to be in the streets. It is directly related to COVID-19 for me, but I ain't judging nobody for being in the streets. I'm not judging anybody for that. Cause as long as we are uprising, and my uprising is helping the folk who are uprising physically, this is how the change is going to come. Yes. And I'm not singing "We Shall Overcome" someday. I'm done with someday. I'm done with someday.
Yeah.
I only have about 2 days.
I'm with you.
Dr. Bridgman, can I have one point to say this? For me, there isn't a dichotomy, but I would be remiss as a young voice right in this moment to say that there isn't an absence of mentorship. And I think that is what I'm calling for. I think this is a generation who does ask, where are the mentors? And I think that part of it is naming, whether it's the church or the mosque or the synagogue, for folks to step up. And maybe it is to say, you know, I'm not going to be the one in the streets, but if I posted on Facebook a couple of days of my 84-year-old grandmother, who's struggling to walk, can get up in a chair and hold her Black Lives Matter sign. She's being the mentor. She's bridging the gap. She's saying, I will sit here and hold the sign and pray for your strength. Baby, you go down there and do the mark. I mean, that's the tension that I'm saying. When we can connect those two, as you beautifully did, I think then we have this symbiotic way of moving forward. In the absence, then you're right, there will be a polarity. It's God called the young and the old, you know, they're not ready. No, I actually am saying, where is the deeper conversation where we can exist in community and the ways in which you are sowing into the lives of theologians now, they connect that to your own legacy of what is now and to come.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's very good.
Yeah. And so Bishop, and I'm glad you're speaking because you get the next question and this will be the last for everyone to answer, but I want to start with you, Bishop. What freedom tools should we be cultivating in order to sustain this present uprising and transform our communities and nation for the long haul? So see, I changed that word because I heard you.
Yes, you did.
Yes.
First of all, I think we need some refreshing and renewed theological education.
Yes.
So that we will know where we came from and where we are. And I think some of the Germans, and excuse me, Dr. Bridgman and Dr. Harris, but I don't know if a lot of the Germans are needed in this time.
I don't know why you're saying excuse me to me, because I sure agree with you.
Okay, so we're in agreement. I just think we need to toss them for right now. And I think we need to push the schools to toss them. And I think we need to make some connection to the writers that are the writers that have the pen of the ready writer for the time that we are in. I think the other thing that we need to lean hard on, and I'm listening to this conversation with Dr. Bridgman and also with Bishop-elect Darrell. I see myself as a mid-generation person. I know my grandparents and my great-grandparents. I know my parents, my grandparents, and some of my great-grandparents. My children of the flesh and spirit, they are my children and they have children of the flesh and spirit. So a lot of us are mid-generational. We have the wisdom and the stories from the people who would be silenced if we don't carry it forward. I have them in my DNA. We are the ones from the hot water cornbread. That's where we are.
Come on now.
That's who we are. We understand chicken. We understand pig feet with a dime in the pot, you know, at New Year's. There are things that we understand that are hard to communicate, but we carry that in us, whether we have a palate for it anymore, we have the memory for it. Right. But we are also listening to our children and to our grandchildren. Remember that wisdom, because the stripes on the back are on the back of those generations. And we are obligated and responsible to move that into the generations that won't know if we don't tell them.
Right.
They don't understand that we've come this far by faith.
That's right.
You know, they don't understand that sometimes the only pushback was to spit in the pot before you served the dinner. You understand that that's all you could do, but you did that as an act of resistance. So to some degree, I think that what we have to do is revamp the teaching of theology to include those things that perhaps in the past were not thought of as theological. And I want to bring in something that we got from Dr. Vernita Weems, who is herself an incredible theologian.
Yes.
But at the same time, she quilts. You know what I mean? And she works with her hands the way her mother and her grandmother worked with their hands. And there's something spiritual about that. We need to remember our smithery. I think you understand me. We need to know that we know how to make preserves. Mm-hmm. And there are things that we know how to go to the garden. My grandmother knew how to go to the garden and get some things when you were sick. And your stomach wasn't working right, and you had a headache. And we lost a lot of that because it was demonized and vilified. We pushed it back, and we gave way to a way of being that was so much more like our oppressor than like the histories and the backgrounds and the realities. You know, there's Bishop Barber called it a morning. There's nothing that blesses me more when it's really rough. I know the songs of the Pentecostals. I don't know who wrote them, but when I tell you they are so in my spirit, when I'm really in a situation, they come up from somewhere. Just like the Baptistals and the Baptist folks, you know, they really get in a bind. And it's, you know, I love the Lord, he heard my cry. Yeah. And you don't have to say it but once. Mm-hmm. And everybody starts rocking. Mm-hmm. Because we have a connection that we need to pass forward. Now, you would think that what I would say is that we need to get a deep education, or we need to get a deep, you know, a brilliant people to come among us and move us so that we can better establish ourselves on the internet. No, that is not what we can really bring to the party.
Right.
We got to go back and embrace our pain. We will not understand this journey, and we will not hand it over well if we dismiss what it really was like for our grandparents, our parents, our great-grandparents, and pull those secrets out, because we've been taught to hush and to be quiet. We need to pull those secrets out and pass them on so that we can connect to the power source. To what really makes us community is not just what we're doing now. It's how we survived before we had the wherewithal to do what we are doing now. I know Bishop-elect Vanessa, that now folks want to eat organic food. And you know, they want to do yoga. I'm down. Okay.
Meditation.
Come on, talk to me.
True.
But there was a time we had a mourner's bench.
Yeah.
And there was a time we cried out to God, in times that only the only way that we prayed was one word. Yes, that was the whole prayer. Yes, that's all we said. Yes. And every time it passed through us, we were yielding in some way to what we believe to be the will of God. So I want to see us come fully to this moment.
It's good.
Not cutting loose where we came from and not making small or diminishing where we are now. And the hope and the dream of the slave, which are our young people mm-hmm. that are doing what they're doing. We got a chance to pull all of that strength together in this. We got a chance to do the dance of the of Beloved, the movie.
Yes.
We got a chance to get out there. Come on, talk to me.
Yeah.
In that circle. Come on here.
What I'm trying, what I was literally trying to get at, Darrell, you already know I love you. So this I'm saying this for other people. They don't know that I love you like that. So that's for somebody else. That wasn't for you. but what I'm trying to get at here, Bishop Flanders, what you have just said is that I think one of the false narratives that arises that keeps us from doing this good and deep work theologically and otherwise is the way people try to separate us.
Yes.
And pretend like we ain't all in the clearing.
Yes.
Right.
It is the way that people try to pretend as if somehow we are being less than Christian. So I'm an herbalist. I think people know this about me. I'm an herbalist and a mystic, and I interpret dreams. I think people know all that about me. If they don't, they now know that. And but what I'm trying to say about that is the way that we try to compartmentalize our theology from the expression of our spirituality.
Yes.
As if those two things are not connected. The way that I talk to my granddaughters and then my granddaughters of the spirit, or grandsons and grand siblings, grandchildren of the spirit, is somehow different from what I'm doing in the classroom.
Yeah.
Or what I'm doing when I'm dealing with the president of the seminary. It's not.
No.
I'm deeply aware that I'm trying to create a world that's safe for all of us, right? Whether they're under 40 or under 10 or over 70 or over 80, that COVID-19 is coming for people in nursing homes. And that matters in this moment, just like the guy, the police officer who shot a drunk man in the back.
Yeah,
that's all he was, a drunk. That's it.
Drunk man.
In the drunk.
He's like, you woke him up drunk, and then you killed him, shot him in the back, and said, "I got him," and then you put your foot on the shoulder and didn't even treat him and call for help for 2 minutes. So I care about that. I care about my 15-year-old granddaughter who had to defriend people because she's because her mom is white and her dad is black a mutt. And her white friend said to her, "Well, George Floyd must have done something to deserve life being shot." So for me, I'm holding all those worlds in my heart.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? I'm holding all those worlds in my heart while I'm talking to professors and saying to them, so who said that the dead German is the canon?
Right.
That's right.
We let them win the theological battle because they lost the war. Well, who said they should be the canon?
It's good.
Will you ask Bishop Pearson for me, because he can hear me, ask him for me how he reconciles being a classic Pentecostal and New Thought at the same time?
Bishop, how do
in
you?
This moment?
Well, I call it metacostalism. I've embraced the metaphysical approach scientifically, spiritually, and philosophically, as I believe Bishop Mason did, and I believe Jesus was a metaphysician. If you just cross the physics into the spirit, Pentecostals were already that. They just are afraid of the terminology because it sounds too scientific or too new age. But if you're spiritual, you're metaphysical.
Yeah.
And the more spiritual you are, the more metaphysical. We call Bishop Mason a root worker because right. he would deal with plants and trees. He was into environmentalism, and that which is a form of Wiccan, a witchcraft, land lovers, Mother Earth, and all that kind of a thing. So it's really a matter of semantics and or language, which the language is changing, and we need to change with it and use the new language. These kids are teaching us something. They're coming up with something new every day. My kids, I've been a pupil of my own children since they were born. I'm learning from them because I realize they came from, I think they came from another planet, but they come from another generation, and they're not bound by the stuff I'm bound with at 67 years old, or that my siblings are. These children are technicians. They're scientists. We are into seances. We want a mediator to connect us with the dead. They ain't looking for the dead. They don't want a seance. They want science, which means knowledge, not faith. Conscience, conscious, means with knowledge, conscientia in Latin. So we're dealing with knowledge. That's what this, as you often hear me say, my Apple phone has an apple with a bite out of it on the back of it. So my Apple, you know, this is the tree or truth of the knowledge of good and evil. There's a knowledge, there's a science to good, there's a science to evil. And so we're learning that from this generation and all this sort of artificial intelligence, it's becoming the official intelligence. Yeah. Because we're having to become technicians and technologists. And I'm open to it. I'm in a learning mode, a learning curve, but a learning mode. And it is, some people say, did I change my mind? I didn't change my mind. Mm-hmm. My mind changed me. Mm-hmm. My thinking shifted, which is what repentance is. Metanoia, to change the nous, the mind, the thinking. After you have thought, think again. Mm-hmm. Reconsider what you believe, why you believe it, how those beliefs add to or subtract from the quality of your life. I'm in that stage. I'm actually in a conflict between what my mind believes, which is what I've been told and taught, and what my soul, literally my cells, know. My cells know what they've experienced. They have memory. And I think they have memory that's pre-incarnate. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. I think there was a knowing before we got here. And now we're experiencing this spiritual amnesia between the womb and the tomb. We forget what we came here knowing, but I'm having this divine deja vu and getting some divine recall, reconnection, recollection, and to the original sound of my purpose in the universe and in the earth. So I'm happier than I've ever been in my life.
That's a long answer to your question, Bishop Billette, okay? Mm-hmm. We are the people of the both and. That is our deliverance. We are not the people of the either or.
That's good. Right.
We are the multiple generations. We have expressed now that we are multiple in our thinking, in our faith paths, in our acceptance. We are internally multiple. We are externally multiple. And what I believe this is that is the revival.
Yeah.
I am permitting myself to be all of myself, homogenized, hallelujah, at the same time.
And to learn from every teacher. So Bishop Elect Goodwin is a teacher for me.
Absolutely.
My 2-year-old or 3-year-old little one is a teacher. And if you're not willing to learn from the babies, you're not willing to learn. You're just not willing to learn because they are closest from the divine. They just got here. And they remember way more than we have.
Right, forgotten.
Right.
So right. Mama's over here saying amen. There she go.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello. Well, one of the things that the both and says in terms of the German, dead Germans and their canonization of truth,
is
they led us into a period of dualism. It always had to be this or that, and not the holistic, not the wholeness of who we were as human beings, God's creation. And much of that internalized theology ended up being internalized oppression that now many Black church pastors share with their people every Sunday that is heaven or hell, that is a two-ness to you rather than a oneness of you. So in terms of responding to the question, I wrote three things that I had thought about and wrote in another article about what the church can do. And I just want to share that as a part of Freedom Tools.
Yes.
Freedom Tools. One, as Bishop Flunder says, theological education or education. And under theology, for Black churches to reject internalized oppression of dominant interpretations of reality through the exercise of critical consciousness and human agency.
Wow. Yes. Love that.
Second two is action, ministry, public ministry, reflection and action upon the social domains of oppression to transform it. There's no sense in pointing white people to the oppression. We are out to transform the oppression.
Yes.
We're just naming it. You have to name it first, but we're naming it to transform it.
Good.
Yes.
And we're not going to continuously let you name it for us.
Good.
You're not going to continue to tell me how I am hurting. You're not going to continue to define my reality. You're not going to pass on definitions to my grandson about who he is and what and how he ought to behave in this culture. I'm going to name it to transform it.
Good preacher.
And then lastly, leadership. That's what Bishop Barber and the Moral Monday and the Breach and Bishop Flunder and all of you others are doing. Leadership, and this is how I define the leadership, is action upon the domains of oppression to transform it. Emancipatory models.
Yes.
To be with emancipatory models.
Models.
Social justice. Yes. That seek to humanize systems through profound love for people and the community. Emancipatory models of leadership through profound love of the people.
Mm.
Our profound love for the people is absent sometimes because we're still trying to make the other folk love us.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We want white people to love us. We want people, we want them to help us get to the point where in you okay now, you all right. No. I don't need you to affirm me. I live from my own.
Come on, Dr. Harris.
I live from my own acceptance. I'm not looking for you to accept me. I'm not looking for you to affirm me. I'm living from my grandmother's affirmation.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
This story comes from my great grandma Charity.
Yes.
And she used to come down from Detroit. And we were in Memphis and we had a big, big tree. And under that tree, she would churn milk, butter and stuff, milk. And we were there watching her churning the milk. Mm-hmm. And a fly, we said, got into the milk.
Just threw
and got up on. And I said, Grandma Charity, there's a fly in the milk. She looked at me, kept on churning. Grandma, there's a fly in the milk. She had snuff, you know, spit stuff out. And she took a little cup, dipped just at the skim of the top of the milk, got the fly off and threw it away. She said, the fly ain't in the milk, the fly is on the milk.
Yeah.
What we have allowed white supremacy, what we've allowed the ideological frames of canons of white American Christianity is to get into us, on us. And if we can just take it and move it away from our imagination,
we
might have a new kind of revolution for Black churches. The sad scenario right here in Nashville, Black pastors can't get together on the need for the police chief to be removed because he has been in the way of oversight of the community.
Yes.
And one group gets on TV and says the chief must go, and another group calls a press conference and says we're for him. Right. It's because white supremacy and for them to like us, we have never got rid of that need for our own need. White people did a job on us. White people did a job on us. They did a job on our churches.
That's what I'm talking about.
We can't see freedom holistically for everybody.
That's right. It.
They can be good on race at some point. They know racism, but they don't have a thing to say about sexism. They don't have a thing to say about the Supreme Court decision that was just made that made discrimination against LGBTQ plus people. They don't have a thing to say. Why you don't have a thing to say? It's because you have not understood the justice of God. And what Kelly Brown Douglas said in her book when she had wrote in response to Ferguson and Michael Brown. Yes. I love the title, Stand Your Ground.
Yes.
But she said what in the subtitle, Black Bodies and the Justice of God.
Yes.
And we not connected Black bodies and the justice of God with all Black bodies.
Yes.
All forms of oppression against Black bodies. And I'm determined to follow Grandma Charity. You know, it's on the milk.
I'm not gonna let racism,
I'm not gonna let the Vanderbilt ethos, the success of a tenured professor, any categories define me. Define us. We've got to start defining ourselves and helping young people who are crying for us in our mentorship to give us definitions of Blackness that whiteness they have nothing to do with.
Come on.
I'm sick of this Blackness that whiteness created. I'm sick of this Blackness
that whiteness
created. And we're so complicit with the whiteness that created the Blackness that sometimes we don't have a distinction between that and us.
So true.
Good.
You're right about it.
You're right, sir. That's good preaching.
So when Jesus comes and makes the distinction about who he is in light of his vision of God's kingdom and reign of love, he could reject the traditionalism of the synagogue. He could reject the empire definition of them.
He
was not satisfied with the empire letting them have synagogues within the Roman Empire.
Right.
We're just satisfied with the empire letting us have our churches.
Right.
Yep.
But not being churches wherein they become transformative agents of change.
Good.
Radicalized.
No, that's
for
so
justice.
Good.
Our churches are not radicalized for justice.
That's right.
Our churches are not radicalized for love.
Right.
If we were radicalized for love, Bishop Flunder, we would not have had the problem with those people that reject.
And Ron Parsley wouldn't get away with it, and neither would
Right.
Right.
All of it's true.
So those tools of freedom is what I offered up is some theological radicalism.
Yes.
I hear that.
And action that's radical. And radicalism meaning thinking to the root of the matter. Get into the root of the pain. Get into the root of the injustice. Get into the root of our lament. Get into the root.
Yes, sir.
You're gonna make me just mess.
He's gone already.
The children have come to the point of birth.
No strength to deliver.
And there is no strength to deliver.
No strength to deliver.
We can't use white theology to deliver them. We can't use the patriarchy, the kind of patriarchy that we've been used to deliver them. We cannot deliver them to a new era of humanity using the same kind of theology that never delivered us.
Yeah. Come on.
Beautiful.
Oh God, that was good.
That was powerful.
I know we got to go, but it's about Juneteenth.
Yes.
How did you feel when you come out the wilderness?
Come out the wilderness.
So, Juneteenth, I lived in Texas for 23 years. And for years, I really resented Juneteenth. I was like, why are we celebrating that we was the last ones to know, blah, blah. You know, I did the white folks thing, to be real honest. But here's what I want to say about Juneteenth and why I celebrate it now and why I think we ought to celebrate anytime anybody recognizes their freedom has come, right? Like, at whatever level of freedom, whether it is you have come out of the closet as LGBTQIA+, whether you have come out of the closet of racism and you have become anti-racist and you're willing to give up whatever privilege came with being a racist, whether you're coming out of sexism and you're willing to take the hit for being anti-sexist, you know, whatever that, whatever, wherever that moment came, Juneteenth came for you, wherever the moment is where you say, okay, I'm going for freedom's sake, and I'm running for freedom, even if that means I gotta leave the flesh pots of Egypt, Bishop, even if that means I gotta give up this job, even if that means I'm losing that inheritance, that there's a joy in freedom that what we consider lack doesn't compare to. Like, we think about what we lose. This is what I'm trying to say. People think about what they lose, but they don't think about what they gain.
Yes.
And there's a gain in freedom that is expansive, that allows you to be in relationships. This last thing I want to say about that, that allows you to be accused like Jesus. You know, I used to say that what I want people to say about me is what they said about Jesus in Luke 15 and 2. He was accused of being a friend of publicans and sinners. He was accused. I want to have the right kind of accusations on my life.
Come on.
Freedom means taking the right kind of accusations on your life.
Right.
And so if Juneteenth means anything to me at this moment, it is having the freedom to have the right accusations and not have to defend myself to anybody for my life. That's it. That's my last word too.
That's good. It was great, Dr. Richman. Thank you so much.
You all have blessed me tonight.
Yes. I'm telling you, I'm ready to shout and run. I found my Kojic roots if I have to.
Shout and run, that's what I want to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just want to offer this last quick word from Howard Thurman in his writing, The Sound of the Genuine.
Yes.
And Howard offers us, if you do not remember the sound of the genuine in you, it would be better if you were not even born.
Yes.
Because anything less than the sound of the genuine is nothing but clanging cymbals and loud noise outside of you.
Yes.
Coming out of the wilderness and true freedom is hearing the sound of the genuine of the Spirit of the living God pulsating through you, accepting you fully and authentically just as you are. And I think when we're able to connect with that, we are setting the world on fire, we will set the world on fire, and there is literally no good thing that God can withhold or the world can withhold or any kind of oppression can hold when you are genuinely exactly who you were created to be.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
That was great.
Yeah.
Amen.
My last word comes through another story, and I won't make it long at all. But in 2003, George Bush came to Nashville at Opryland to give a speech to religious broadcasters. And I was invited, along with other minister leaders and so forth, to have a word with him before he went on stage. And all night I wrestled, because it was right at the time of the Iraq war beginning. And I knew I couldn't sit in that room, in that space with him and keep down this need to say something about that war. So we got in the room, and they went around the room, and people introduced themselves, made a little statement and so forth and so on. The room went opposite my direction, so I was nearly last. And when he got to me, Bush seemed like he had gotten tired of hearing the BS too, you know, just political correct stuff. And he's turned to me and says, "And what's your story?" And if he hadn't said it that way, I probably would have responded just like them, politically correct. I said, "Mr. President, do all you can not to go to war."
Wow.
The Secret Service, the room changed, the tension in the room rose, and I said to myself, "Don't do anything else. You see what's going on." And after the meeting was over, He came to shake my hand. And Darrell, you would not believe, I put a prayer in his hand by Thurman. I had written a little sticky note. And when I shook his hand, I said, when you get back on Air Force One, when you get a chance, read this prayer. Mm-hmm. Because if you can not go to war, I said it again, you would establish yourself as a peacemaker in history. Mm-hmm. I went back to school, it was chapel at ABC, and I went back to chapel with those students. And time I got there, I ran straight to the podium. I said, I tell you what you're going to do. You're going to get your lessons. You're going to learn how to pray. You're going to learn Black history. You're going to do everything. Because I didn't have no idea that today I would be in a position to say anything to the President of the United States. What we've got to do in this moment is to prepare ourselves and our young people to speak and to be ready to speak. R-I-P-E, right to speak into this situation. And tonight, I got a whole lot of right wisdom from Bishop Flunder, Brother Barbara, Brother Peterson, and you, Darrell, and my good friend. I'm just full, Vanessa. I'm full. I'm ready to go, and I'm ready to do the best I can on this journey. So thank you for letting me be a part of this conversation.
Thank you. Thank you for being a part. Thank you all for being a part on tonight. I want to say James Baldwin wrote a book many years ago called The Fire Next Time. Yeah. And I believe that these uprisings that we are experiencing in the streets of Harlem and Omaha and California and Ohio and Oklahoma and wherever anyone might be, this is the fire next time. This is the uprisings that are taking place all over the world. I pray that it spreads far and fast. God bless you all for joining Beyond the Gatekeepers. Thank you so much. I have a few announcements. Thank you, Facebook Live, for holding with us. Thank you, each and everyone, Dr. Bridgman, Dr. Harris, Bishop Pearson, Reverend Darrell, Bishop Barbara, and of course, Bishop Yvette Flunder. Thank you so very, very much. We have some announcements that we want to make sure that the audience gets as well.
Thank you, everyone. We love you.
Thank you.
Bless you, Bishop. You.
Great meeting all of you.
Thank you so much.
Bless you. Mass Poor People's Assembly and Moral March on Washington is going digital. June 20th, 2020, Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, repairers of the breach. We want you to fight poverty and not the poor, because we are rising. If you need more information, the website is there, www.june2020.org. You need to register for this. It is going to be online. It will be digital. Save the date, July 14th through the 16th, 2020 will be the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries Virtual Leadership Conference, featured sessions, pre-recorded meditation, welcome plenary, Smith Talks, performing arts and technology, interactive lounge, political engagement, and evolutionary theology and prophetic liturgy. So mark your calendars. You can register via Eventbrite, and it will be Zoom video conferencing. We thank God for our presiding bishop, Yvette Flunder, and also our Episcopal assistant, Bishop Wyatt Greenlee. Our theme this year is co-creating with God, co-creating with God. We hope that you will register for this conference. We look forward to seeing you online. And finally, if you want more information about tonight's panelists, you can go to find Bishop William Barber II at www.reachrepairers.org. Dr. Valerie Bridgman, you can find her at www.womanpreach.org. Bishop Flunder, you can find her at www.radicallyinclusive.org/bishop-flunder. Reverend Darrell Goodwin can be found via Facebook, www.facebook.com/Darrell.Goodwin. Dr. Forrest E. Harris Sr. can be found at www.abcnash.edu. And last but not least, Bishop Carlton Pearson. You can find him at www.bishoppearson.com. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. You have been a tremendous blessing. If you want to support our weekly broadcast by sowing a seed via Cash App, please do so to $TFAMAnnual. That's $TFAMAnnual. And last but not least, we want to give credit to our beginning video, Juneteenth, Freedom at Last, and also our beginning song intro, Black America Again by Common and Stevie Wonder. And have a great night.
Are fastened in the windows pinned. Keep your hand on that plow. Hold on. Noah said you done lost your track. Can't plow straight and keep a looking back. Keep your hand on that plow. And hold on. Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Keep your hand on that plow and hold on.
And hold.